Hey, I'm Gav, and welcome back to the channel, where today we're talking about Lord of the Rings, specifically this Lord of the Rings, and why it's the best Lord of the Rings video game out there.
Hey! Listen!
Lord of the Rings Return of the King is one of the most critically acclaimed movies of all time. It won 11 Oscars, so it was only right that when creating a video game to go along with the film, it was also of the highest caliber. Now, unlike my video on Star Wars Battlefront 2, where I just gave my opinion on what the best Star Wars game of all time was, this video is straight facts. This is the best Lord of the Rings game out there. So after the success of creating a game for the Two Towers, EA decided to start working on a larger, less linear game for the third and final film in Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings trilogy. A point to note that there was no game based on the Fellowship of the Ring because actually, EA didn't have the rights to turning Tolkien's books into games, just the films. Vivendi Games had the license there, and they were releasing a Fellowship-centered game completely based around the books. So this is why if you've played The Two Towers, you know that there's quite a lot of the Fellowship sprinkled in there. Anyway, we're getting completely sidetracked here.
I think I do have a special gift for gaming.
So the game starts right at the end of the Battle of Helm's Deep when Gandalf shows up with the Riders of Rohan and horse on in and save the day. You then get to play the end of the battle, which is quite exciting if you've seen the film because you can get straight stuck in on the action. This basically acts as a tutorial for the game. Now, it's a hack and slash, so you've got your basic light attack, your heavy attack, your ranged ability. The game does a good job of explaining it to you. There are also combos and team moves, and the combat is fairly in-depth for a movie tie-in game. And the fact that you can level up abilities for the characters, it does provide a decent amount of variation in the gameplay. After each level, you get a chance to spend your experience points on new combos and abilities, and obviously some are better than others. I mean, by the end of the game, you can turn Legolas into a machine gun wielding cosmic elf. You can also get fellowship upgrades for the whole squad, which give everyone a new combo for only a little bit more XP. So once you finish the tutorial level, the game splits off into three narratives, which I think is a nice way to show the game because it sort of mirrors the movie. So you get three options. You get the Path of the Wizard, which follows Gandalf and his adventures. You get the Path of the King, which follows the trio of Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli on their quests. And then you get the Path of the Hobbits, which you relive the boring parts of the movie. It certainly wasn't my favourite. My personal favourite was The Path of the King. I mean, it's mainly just because it followed my three favourite characters from the Fellowship. Each path is loosely followed on the events of the movie, and they fill in the gaps when needed. The Path of the Wizard takes you through the Fangorn Forest chasing the last of the Uruk-hai from Helm's Deep, and that culminates in the Ents attack on Isengard. It then follows Gandalf and Pippin on their way to Minas Tirith and the defense of the castle from there, and pretty much follows the film after that. The Path of the King probably deviates from the film the most, as it starts with the trio on the hunt for the Army of the Dead, which you spend a lot of time fighting ghosts until a boss battle with the King of the Dead, which I don't really remember happening in the film. And then you've got to escape the tunnels while they fall down and try to kill you. It's fairly different. Now between this and catching up with the film story, you play one of probably my favourite levels. It's called the Southern Gate. This is the trio between finding the Army of the Dead and on their way to the big battle.
Armed with an oath of allegiance from an army long dead, Aragorn's road will at last lead him back to the White City. He shall head northward and then through Gondor's Southern Gate.
I played this level over and over and over and over and over again, because if you just stay at the first part of the level, enemies just keep on spawning, and if you didn't climb up the gate, you could just spend a good half an hour just mowing down enemies to get a perfect score, finishing off combos and increasing your XP. From there you've got the Battle of Pelennor Fields and pretty much the rest of the film. Now both these arcs culminate in the Battle of the Black Gate.
We have drawn his army to the Black Gate. For ourselves, there is no hope. This is our final act to give Frodo time. Time to end this evil that marshals before us.
For the Path of Hobbits, you just do what the Hobbits do, fight Gollum, and then game over. Cool. Next part.
You give me that back! Biting my finger off won't stop me!
So let's talk about characters. Now in the main game, you can play as your Fellowship mainstays, and then once you finish the game, there's some bonus characters to be unlocked as well. Specifically Faramir, Merry, and Pippin. They all play pretty much the same as the rest of the characters, but they are fun additions. With this being a movie tie-in, a lot of these characters are voiced by their respective actors. The only big misses are Aragorn and Legolas, who aren't portrayed by Viggo and Orlando. And, you know, their replacement actors are not great.
I shall give you a message for your master!
I mean, heck, they even got Christopher Lee and Ian McKellen to reprise their roles, so where were the others? So another cool thing you can do is go back and replay levels in co-op with different characters. You know, you want to take Aragorn through Shelob's lair? You can do that. Or maybe you fancy having Gandalf along for the Path of the Dead. You can do that. Or maybe you want to replace Frodo with Legolas for the final mission against Gollum. Okay, you can't do that, but it would be pretty funny. So with this being a licensed movie tie-in, you get a lot of great scenes from the film. Albeit a lot from the Two Towers, but they have this weird blending from animation to live action, and as a kid I probably thought that looked really cool, but now it's starting to look a little bit janky. Also, Howard Shore's wonderful score is in the game, and it just makes you feel like you're fighting for the freedom of the men of the West, and it's pretty fantastic. I think the reason this game is so great is because it's got a pick-up-and-play aspect to it. It's not overly challenging, and the fact that you can play it with a friend just gives it a wide scope of people that could play it. Because most people will know the story, and well, it's just nice to jump into Middle-earth and play along. Quick fun fact, this game was developed by EA Redwood Studios, who later became Visceral Games, who created the Dead Space games. They were then supposed to create a Star Wars game before EA closed them down in 2017. Cheers for that, EA. Overall, this game is just a blast. And although I love a lot of the other Lord of the Rings games, this one just has so many memories and so much replayability value. And I do find myself jumping back in more than the other ones. That's if I can get it to work. Look, if you're a Lord of the Rings fan and you haven't played this game, I highly recommend it. It can be a bit difficult to find. I think I managed to find mine in a secondhand store for about £2.50. And it can be a little bit of a pain to run, but if you can get it running on a PC or a PlayStation with some friends, I promise you, it's an absolute blast of a game. And probably the best Lord of the Rings game. Right, I suppose that'll do it. If you enjoyed the video, why not drop a like, drop a subscribe. If you'd like to see me ramble some more about games, why not follow me on Twitch. But for now, I'm gonna go rewatch Lord of the Rings. See you later.